To all the participants of Provision 2020. Provision 2020, the webinar series hosted by Fathamulla Homeopathic Medical College, provides a platform from all the homeopathic practitioners as well as the students to enhance their knowledge by listening to the standards in the field of homeopathy as well as to share their clinical experience. Today, we will be listening to Dr. Srinivasan on the topic, the pattern Burger Synoptic Key. I take this opportunity to welcome our administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Craster, our principal, Dr. Shivprasad K, and our vice principal, Dr. E.S.J. Prabhugiran. I also welcome our moderator for this session, Dr. Kurian P.J., Associate Professor, Department of Repertory, Fathamulla Homeopathic Medical College. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Raisa, for the welcome speech. Now, let me take the liberty to introduce the topic as well as to introduce the speaker. Today's topic is a little unique one because this topic is less trodden by the homeopath. This topic belongs to Bonninghausen School of Philosophy, and there are only few takers for this school of homeopathy. After Bonninghausen, we have Boger, and after Boger, we have Fartak. And after Fartak, there is a long gap of silence. Recently, a new doctor known as Dr. Dimitriadis from Australia have once again revived this school of homeopathy, Bonninghausen School of Homeopathy. In this school of homeopathy, Boger Synoptic Key carries a special place. The reason is, this is the only book in which all the main elements of homeopathy, namely Organon, Repertory, and Materia Medica, is fused into one small book. The preface of this book speaks about the Organon, the synoptic part speaks about the Repertory, and the synthetic part speaks about the Materia Medica. And in today's session, our speaker, Dr. Srinivasan, will try to help us to identify certain types of pattern representation in the patient. And these patterns will be used to identify or detect the simlimum using the synoptic key. So this is the brief introduction of the topic. Coming to the speaker, he has requested me personally to give him the shortest introduction of him. But let me take the liberty to say that Dr. Srinivasan, who is a staunch follower of classical homeopathy, is currently a faculty member of Shivaraj Homeopathic Medical College, Salem. He graduated from Vinayaka Mission and he postgraduated from Maharashtra University of Health Science. And he will help us to identify the patterns in the patients. So, Dr. Srinivasan, I request you to take over the stage and enlighten us about this pattern recognition. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. I'm audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. So the interesting background we see a pattern around us every minute, every day. See the plant, a single plant, the leaves are arranged in a certain way. The stems are arranged in a certain way. The flowers blossom in a certain way. And the fruit, if we open it and see, there is a pattern which is unique for that plant. And that plant belongs to one species, so there is similarity of pattern in that species. Then we see a group of plant, which is called as genus, genera, which share certain pattern similarity, then that falls under family, and that falls under an order. Like this, we go up and up. All this comes under plant kingdom. So every species, every plant has a pattern. We try to see, and through that we learn how a single plant is unique, how it has similarity with its own siblings, and how it is different from other genera, other family, other order, and the sharing similarities as well. Another common example we see around is animals. You take a cat, the single cat has own pattern in its anatomy, physiology. Then there is cat family, like that, and we differentiate. Then we take chemicals, minerals, we see an entire periodic table, rows and columns, left to right, above down. They share certain common pattern and uniqueness and differentiation, either as single element or as compound. That's a beautiful pattern in everything around us, nature, planetary motion, there is a pattern. And still interestingly, if you see the newspaper, if you watch television, the police will catch criminals on the basis of the pattern of crime every group or an individual commit. There's a pattern in a criminal doing the crime, in the group doing the crime. With that, police will be able to delineate who is the culprit and catch hold of. Astrology is absolute mathematics, irrespective of religion. Every minute, they will be able to foresee this will happen. Every day, every week, every fortnight, every month, you know, every year, every 60 years, if you closely calculate, observe, there is a definite pattern in astrology. So if you closely calculate, if you're very sharp in observation, very sharp in mathematical calculation, you can predict what will happen in future. So depending on this ability to observe closely and mathematical accuracy, you will be able to come to the pattern of predicting future in every individual. You see the human beings, one individual, you see the pattern, the eyes, nose, mouth, you know, the anatomy, the physiology, there is a pattern in an individual, there is a pattern among human beings, a society, there is a pattern among races, you know, Caucasians share certain commonalities, the Asians share certain commonalities, the Africans share certain commonalities, and they have differences as well. So in the same way, we have seen so many examples, the plant pattern, the animal pattern, the mineral pattern, the planetary movement pattern, criminals pattern, astrological pattern, human patterns. We now come to the homeopathic patterns. Every drug produces symptoms in a specific pattern. The location they affect, the organs they affect, the tissues they affect, the system they affect has a definite pattern if we carefully read, proving Materia Medicus. And the sensation they produce, there is a pattern. The modalities that modify these symptoms, there is a pattern. The concomitants they produce, there is a pattern. The generalities they produce, there is a pattern. So by very carefully reading Materia Medica of one drug, we understand the pattern of that drug. Then gradually a mental image developed in each of us, how to read Materia Medica, how to read a drug, and then the second drug, third drug, fourth drug. Then we gradually understand, have a grasp on the pattern of family remedies, the pattern of order remedies, the pattern of kingdom remedies. Plant remedies has certain pattern, animal remedies has certain pattern, mineral remedies has certain pattern. They have general features running through and through, and they have differentiating features as well. So it's our job primarily to grasp the pattern of one remedy and from that come to more remedies and then grouping it. This is possible by thoroughly reading proving materia medicas, and later we can use commentary materia medicas, keynotes or whatever. Okay, so the very idea of this presentation is to impinge this idea in the minds of the participant that we should see the pattern of the drug from materia medica provings. And second most important is how to take the case and find out the pattern of problem, the pattern of location, the pattern of sensation, the pattern of modality, the pattern of concomitant in the case, and thirdly, where to see that in Bogart synoptic key, how to see it, and on applying it clinically, what happens to the patient and the outcome. So our objective is this: take the case, find out the pattern in the patient, refer appropriate rubric in Bogart synoptic key, and apply the repertory result and see what happens clinically. And this we will do with a single case. Okay, so the idea is to introduce the concept and show it through a single case. Okay, I'll go to the next slide. As I have told you, there is pattern in plants, animals, minerals, astrology, crime criminals, how police identify them, drug proving, materia medica. We carefully see all these things around us. You know, very interestingly, if you watch our teachers when they take the class, the way they dress up, the way they conduct themselves, how they walk, you know, the words they use, how they express, it's very, very interesting experience. You just see them closely day after day after day, there will be a definite pattern. You know, you can even foresee and tell them, see, this doctor is going to take this class today. He will come or she will come with this kind of dress. You know, it's so interesting, fascinating. You can watch them so closely and it's an interesting exercise. And same thing we can apply in our practice and see our patients as well. And apply it by cross-referring with materia medica and repertory and produce results wonderfully. Okay. Now coming to the patient, I am presenting only the salient feature of the case which I have taken to convey that concept. I am presenting only the totality that I have taken, but please understand that I have taken the case fully as it is systematically taught in colleges. You know, we take the basic data of name, age, gender, address, and all that. Then present complaints, description of present complaints with the location, sensation, modality, concomitant, extension, and all that. Then the past illness, whichever is relevant. Then the family history. Then life space, the emotion life, the nature of the person, the emotional aspect which has affected the person, physical generals, and all that. The case was thoroughly taken. And for want of time and space, I am presenting only the essential points that convey the concept I am introducing today. This, the concept is nothing new. It is same what Bioning was introduced early. From particular to general, that's all. I'm just using a different word. It is pattern. And how we are going to use it in Bogart synoptic and the result of that. Okay, the patient says the salient point of the case, the sweat is staining his cloth white, and when it becomes too dry, when he examined the cloth, there is very fine white granules where there was profuse sweating. Point number one. Okay, and he observed another beautiful point. The sweat is so profuse, and this complaint of white staining and fine white granules come when he works near fire a lot. When it is overheating of the body, the sweat is of this nature. Okay, and another important thing I always cross verify with patient: when there is a particular complaint which is very severe, which is very troublesome, I carefully verify whether there is any concomitant physical symptom, number one. Number two, whether there is any particular change in emotion, conduct, behavior of that individual. Say for example, when patient says I am having headache, when the headache is very severe, I ask, is there any other accompanying complaint? There may be physical complaint or may not be, or whether there is any change in your emotion, conduct, behavior. Some patients say I get very angry, some patient feels I feel desperate, some patient says I feel very sad, some patient says I still remain happy, jolly person only, there is no absolute change along with my present complaint. So when the sweat is more, and when the sweat is causing this much of stain, the patient says I still remain the same person, there is no accompanying physical changes, no accompanying change in my emotion or conduct or behavior, I remain the same jolly person, I just continue. Okay, so the first point is sweat is causing white staining of the cloth, and later when it dries up, he examines and there is fine white granules. Okay, and this kind of sweat and staining and white granules come especially when he works near fire, when the body gets overheated, irrespective of any season. Okay, and there is no accompanying physical symptom along with the sweat pattern, or there is no change in his emotion, conduct, behavior, he remained the same jolly person all through. Okay, so we'll go to next slide. Another complaint which the patient told is about the urine. When he uses the Western commode, when he uses the Indian commode, or he is from a small place, when he goes to the outside the place, he passes urine on the ground. If the land is dry, when he visits that place next morning, in all these places, when it stays, it leaves white granules as a urinary sediment. So another very important point which patient has noticed, and this kind of urinary complaint is more during summer exertion days, when he goes out in summer and exert a lot, when a body becomes heated up, this kind of urinary complaint is more prominently noticed by this patient. And along with this urinary complaint, there is no accompanying physical changes, but emotionally also he remains the same, like a jolly person, as generally his nature is. He is a jolly person, and there is no accompanying emotional or mind changes in nature. Okay, so now we are slowly seeing three common threads. One is in the complaint, and second is in the modality, third is in his nature. You know, there are two complaints we have seen so far, and you see few common threads which is connecting. Let us see more, the third complaint. And another interesting point. And
Dr. Srinivasan, sorry to interrupt you. Your audio is having certain problem. Do you have any option of a secondary internet connection, or coming closer towards the modem, or anything which you can improve the Wi-Fi?
Wi-Fi is perfect. and I am sitting as close as possible to the mic Modern. System.
Okay, okay.
Yes, sir. Now it is clear.
Now it is very clear.
Okay. Okay. Right. Thank you. So you want me to repeat two slides, which is very important.
I'll yes, tell yes, you very yes, quickly. Yes, yes, please.
So audience will follow.
Yes, yes, please.
So the first complaint after full case taking, which is very important to emphasize the today's presentation concept, patient was having profuse sweat, which stains the cloth white, and when it dries, leaves a very fine white granules. And this kind of sweat pattern comes when the patient works more near the fire for domestic work or related to his job, and his body gets overheated up. And there is no accompanying very strong clear-cut physical concomitant and no emotional change. He remains the same jolly emotional person. So this is complaint number one, which was very significant in the case. So complaint number two, which was showing this thread, was the urine. When it stays on the ground or in the commode, he has observed very fine white granules, and this kind of urine granules is more characteristic when he exerts a lot in summer, and even if he drinks more water, these granules are found. So when body gets overheated, this urinary symptom he has observed, and there is no accompanying physical concomitant or change in mood or emotion, but he remains the same person in urinary complaint as well. So now, third important peculiarity which the individual observed was the inner canthi has very fine white salty dust in the mornings on waking, and that too when he goes out in sun and play a lot, irrespective of any season, not only in summer, in a wintry season, he comes from a warm place. Even on winter days, if he plays out in a warm sun and comes back next day, or he goes in a hot place, then also next day on waking up, he has found many small, fine, white, salty dust. And I was curious. I asked him, can you please bring it next time when you come over? He has brought it in very fine, dark sheet. And it was so obvious. I had a doubt whether he was bringing it from his kitchen. I cross-checked with his family members. They say, yes, sir, we have observed that in his eyes. Yes, it is true, it is happening there. Okay. So the most prominent modality that is more found is when he plays in very hot sun and his body gets heated up. The accompanying concomitant symptom is not clear. No emotional change as well. The nature is the same, like a cheerful person. So we have seen three complaints. One is the lacrimation, the second is urine, and third one is the sweat. All these, you know, we are seeing one common thread in the complaint. All the particles are white salty dust. And the modality that produces this characteristic problem or physical end product is sun heat, fire heat, playing in hot sun or summer season, overexertion. So the heat in various forms is playing up with this individual and producing this complaint very definitely. And third is, I'm looking for a physical concomitant or emotional concomitant all through. There is no physical concomitant, and the nature of the person is remaining the same. Okay, so we are seeing a pattern in the complaints, the modality, and the emotion of the person. When the emotion changes, say with a headache, say for example, person says, I am very angry. When there is stomach pain, patient says, I am very angry. With the knee pain, patient says, I am very angry. Otherwise, I am a jolly person. I will take anger as the mental concomitant and use it for repertorization. So here, there is no physical concomitant, no emotional change. So we'll take the nature of the person as concomitant and use it in repertory. Let us see how I have worked out this case and what is the reference and what is the repertory result. Now I will use another screen share. Okay. So the common mind rubric or commonality running through all the three complaints is the nature of the person remaining unaltered. So what I do is the working method with physical complaint. If there is a very strong physical concomitant, I try to see the pattern in physical concomitant. If it is available, I will use it. Second working method, if with physical complaint, there is a strong emotional behavioral change, and if there is a pattern, I try to use it. The third possibility is, if the physical complaint is not there, emotional change is not there, the nature of person remains the same with all the complaint, I use it. So here in this case, the nature of the person remained the same all through. So I am taking this mind as concomitant pattern in all the three complaint. The reference with Boger synoptic key is, please go to mind chapter. Under that, you will find animation, vivacity, cheerfulness, exaltation. Boger is unique in zipping so many things into one rubric. What Kent says in one lecture, Boger says nearly in one word. So we have to read Boger very, very carefully and elaborate each word and see its application in clinic. So here I am using the cursor. You see mind, animation, vivacity, cheerfulness, exaltation. So for initial 5 years, I recommend the beginners to use manual repertorization. You become familiar with the book. So by opening the physical book, it may initially consume little time and requires more effort, but it is worth doing it because you become more and more familiar. When you search for one rubric, when you read one rubric, you will see more rubrics in the same page, same column, and the other page as well. So you become more conversant with the work. So it's better we use physical repertory initially. The software repertory, of course, it saves time, energy, which can be taken up, and a quick search and wider search is possible. But for initial 5 years, I request the initial practitioners and students to do manual repertorization. And third option is the online repertorization. The online repertory I use for Boger synoptic key is a homeoint, homeoint.org, homeoint.org, and you can open it and see Boger synoptic key repertory given as it is in the book. Okay, so Boger synoptic key has one uniqueness. One is it has main repertory and the supplement reference table, which is given in the last pages. The main repertory is given in a chapter-wise order. Supplement reference is given in alphabetical order. Okay, so we have to go to supplement reference table, see under animation whether any extra rubric is given, any extra remedy is given. Then you check with vivacity the word, see whether any word vivacity is given in the supplement reference table and any remedy is given additionally. Then you check with cheerfulness, see whether any extra remedy is available. Check with exaltation, see whether extra any remedy is given. If extra remedy is given, please write along with these main rubric remedies also. Okay. So here I have checked with main rubric and the supplement reference table for each word, animation, vivacity, cheerfulness, and exaltation. and I have put all the remedies together. The remedies are aurum metallicum, belladonna, cannabis, coffea, crocus, hyoscyamus, natrum curb, opium, platina, spongia, and stramonium. Okay, so the common pattern in mind rubric is animation, vivacity, cheerfulness, exaltation, and we have written down these remedies for all the participants here. I recommend one book. Maybe many of you are very conversant with the book, Repertory of Nosodes, Sarcodes, and Imponderables by Berkeley Square. It's a wonderful systematic repertory of how to use nosode repertory, how to arrive at nosode, sarcode, imponderable, which is indicated then on any conceptual basis of psychotic miasm, this nosode, syphilitic miasm, this nosode, psoriatic miasm, this nosode, tubercular miasm, this nosode. The repertory is very, very systematic. In that, Berkeley Square gives a very beautiful and a logical account on why not to use the gradations and marks while repertorizing. So since reading that book, which was introduced to us in the year 1999 by Dr. Veerabhadra Rao, we stopped using grades and marks when we repertorize. This may be against what is taught in the college, what is there in your syllabus, and what you had been using all these years. But try this. Berkeley Square gives a very beautiful logical account on why not to use grades and marks. Because this is not the scope of this presentation, I am not elaborating it. Please read it. It's very beautiful account. And very simple reason, your indicated remedy, your indicated nosode may be running through and through with one mark, one grade, and that may be curative. Many cases where we have repertorized with higher grade marks, higher grade remedies, we might have missed the curative remedy and therefore the failure. So when we include even the lowest grade marks, lowest grade remedies, the remedy may be curative and present in all in one grade and one mark, we have solved a good number of cases. So please try in one case to incorporate all the remedies in all the grades and marks and see you are able to hit the right curative remedy. Okay, so since the year 1999, I am not using grades and marks when I use repertory table. So you also please try it and give me a feedback. Now we'll go back to the screen share of the slideshow. And the diagnostic part, the patient was a diabetic on insulin along with gout also. When patient with such a diagnosis and on treatment comes to me, I offer them four schemes of treatment, four ideas of treatment. Number one, they can discontinue all the allopathic medicines they are taking, come back with clear-cut symptoms, and take only homeopathy. If patient has that much of conviction, and I am very sure about what I am doing, that I am very responsible, and to attend to patient at any day or any time, and I'm very sure that I will produce result and there will be no complication. So that is scheme number one. Scheme number two, I tell the patient, you discontinue allopathic medicine, take homeopathic medicine, and if symptom crisis come, you may take allopathic medicine if you are not responding to homeopathy as fast as we want. Allopathic medicine, SOS. This is scheme number two. Scheme number three, patient can continue all the medicine they are taking, and along with that, they will take homeopathic medicine prescribed on the basis of generalities. And as patient feels significant improvement in their health before homeopathy and after homeopathy, when they gain confidence, they can gradually taper allopathic medicine, consulting the concerned specialist, and stop it. Then take homeopathy only and stop homeopathy also in the due course of time. So this is scheme number three. Scheme A, stop allopathy with clear-cut symptom, start homeopathy. Scheme B, stop allopathy, take homeopathy and SOS allopathy. Scheme three, take both simultaneously, and depending on the improvement percentage and pattern, gradually taper allopathy and take homeopathy only. And scheme four, they can start anywhere and switch to other schemes as well. So I discuss these options with patient and leave it to their choice. And we travel along with patient and produce results. So this is four schemes what I follow. And then regarding the diet, habit, lifestyle, same thing I tell to them. You can switch back to pre-diabetic or whatever chronic disease diet and see clear-cut diagnosis and changes. And accordingly, we can make changes in your diet, habit, lifestyle. And the third important point, as a homeopath, instead of giving a systematic or a protocol diet, protocol habit, protocol lifestyle to them, we encourage them to observe desire, aversion, aggravation. And accordingly, we can select rubric and a remedy and give it and leave everything else to the patient and observe. Okay, so this is the greatest advantage of the homeopathic doctor, by encouraging the patient to speak about the desire, speak about the aversion, observe aggravations carefully, than having any theoretical understanding and report to us. Accordingly, we can select the rubric from Materia Medica repertory and prescribe and produce wonderful changes. Even if patient continues to have sugar, sweets, even if the patient is diabetic. So these are the things very commonly I teach to my students and practitioners, and same thing I do with my patients, and the results are wonderful. Okay. And the most common formula of rubric selection when I use Boger synoptic key is one rubric from mind, the concomitant emotion. It could be the nature of the person or the concomitant emotion. Sometimes it could be the physical symptom which is concomitant. So the idea is to use concomitant definitely. The concomitant could be a physical concomitant, or it could be an emotional concomitant, or it could be the mind type which is running through and through. So rubric number two, the sensation pattern. Say for example, it could be a burning sensation, it could be a pricking sensation, it could be a bursting sensation. So sensation pattern, or the complaint pattern. Here we see the complaint pattern is the salty deposits, or the saltiness through and through. So that is rubric number two. And the rubric number three is modality. It would be aggravation or it would be amelioration. Here I use the word bullet modality. What I insist is the success rate of modality, the probability of modality being highly useful. The four component, four filters, if the modality runs through four filters, I find it highly efficacious, highly useful, highly effective. The success percentage is more if filter number one, the modality applies to both the gender. It should be present in men and women. Filter number two, it applies to all geographical location. In high altitude, low altitude, earth level or near the sea, whatever. And filter number three, it applies to all age group. Infant, neonate, adult, old age, whatever. And filter number four, if it's available on a daily basis, you know, movement, position, eating, all these things are available on a daily basis. The simple reason is then the drug and the modality probability of being proved is very high. Then the success rate is very high. So I repeat, we have four filters, the modality available in both gender, in all age group, in all geographical location, and on a daily basis. So here we will see whether the filter is applied in the rubric what we have taken, and then see what has happened to the case. Okay. So the pattern, I told you three rubrics. Rubric number one, the mind pattern. The mind pattern or the physical concomitant pattern or the change in mind. So the mind pattern here is the physical concomitant is not available. The emotional change is not available. The emotion or the mind pattern that is running through and through is he's a jolly happy person. And I have shown you the rubric mind, animation, cheerful, vivacious. And please see when you are using Bogle Synoptic Key, the physical book, please check in the main chapter, main rubric, and definitely in supplemental reference table, and also for each word given in main rubric. And I have shown you, I'll just share. The mind, the pattern, animation, vivacity, cheerfulness, exaltation. And this, every member has to see each word in supplement reference table. And if additional remedies are given, add it into the main repertory and continue to use for repertorization. Okay. Then we'll come to the second rubric. From the PowerPoint. The sensation pattern or the complaint pattern, sometimes it would be location pattern, you know, more than one joint is affected, the joint will become the rubric. If more the muscles are affected, muscles could be the rubric, you know. Your skin, more symptoms are present. So the tissue affected could be a rubric. The organ affected could be a rubric. The system affected could be a rubric. You know, sensation is a rubric. The complaint is a rubric. Here, the sensation we are deriving from the three complaints, sweat, staining the cloth white, fine white granules, urine with fine white granules, lacrimation morning on waking, inner canthi, white salty dust. So what is running through and through? The word that connect all the three. Here we are deriving from particular to general, saltiness. You know, that word saltiness is running through and through in all the three complaints. And this rubric is there in Bogle Synoptic Key. The sweat leaves saltiness, urine leaves salty granules, lacrimation leaves salty white dust. So the commonality, the pattern of this is saltiness. Now we will see the rubric in Bogar Synoptic Key, main chapter and supplement reference table. I'll show you the word. Here you see saltiness in main repertory, and the same word got added up from supplement reference table. There are remedies: fluoric acid, graphitis, iodum, and the stanicula. So these remedies I take and write along with main repertory remedies. Is this okay? Now we can work out with two methods. One is, here itself you calculate the remedies commonly present in mind and salty rubrics. Remedies present in both, you can write down separately as continuous elimination. So next repertory rubric, when we add, the manual labor will be less. Or you let all the remedies be present, we can finally see which remedies are commonly present in all the three and form repertory totality also. Either way, continuous elimination or do the repertory totality at the end. Okay, now we'll go back to the slideshow and see what is the third rubric. So we were discussing about the bullet modality. Here for the first complaint, it was more or marked or present when the person works near the fire. Urinary symptoms are worse in the summer exertion days when his body gets heated up unduly, and lacrimation symptom when he plays a lot in sun, not mere play, but lot. So the most common thing that is running through and through is being heated up. Okay, so being heated up can be possible in both gender, in all age group, in all geographical location, and on a daily basis. Okay, if we have a sunny heat. So therefore I am taking this as a modality pattern, and the rubric we will see in Bogar Synoptic Key, the chapter is conditions of aggravation, amelioration in general, which you will see in the early pages itself, not at the end. And heat of fire, heat of sun, becoming heated or overheating, etc., aggravate, compare sun. So Bogar zip so many things under single rubric. So we have to read very, very, very carefully each rubric and refer it in appropriate supplement reference table and add remedies wherever it is present and use it very, very carefully. So I'm repeatedly emphasizing to see remedies in main repertory rubric and see for each word in supplement reference table, which is given in alphabetical order, and add it to the main repertory and check whether we are adding right remedy, working out and coming to that which will help us in solving the case. Okay, now we'll go to the word. Here. Heat of fire, sun, becoming heated or overheating, etc. See, Bogar is not yet convinced. He has given so many varieties of heating. Still, he says, etc. also. So, we will come across many types of heating heating, heated up, overheating. So Boger gives room for including those also and using this rubric. So I have written down all this and from the supplement reference table also. Heat aggravate, that is one remedy. Heated being, here Boger has not given the word aggravation, but where it is not given separately, please understand, it is to be taken as aggravation. There is one remedy. So I'm adding these remedies to the main repertory remedies. And finally, I have calculated. Now, all of you can see for yourself and just write in your note, or you're able to type it. See whether one remedy or more remedies are coming in common in all the three. You can either type it for yourself or write it down. See, this is rubric number one, mind. This is rubric number two, including supplement reference table, which is the pattern of the sensation or complaint, salty, saltiness. This is rubric number three, which is pattern of modality from main rubric and supplement reference table. Okay. Now we'll go back to the PowerPoint. So I'm just repeating the emphasis of types of rubric I am taking. The formula of rubrics: concomitant emotion or nature of the person, or if there is a concomitant physical symptom pattern, we can take it. The sensation pattern, complaint pattern, and modality pattern. The mind type here we have taken is animation, cheerful, vivacious. Sensation complaint pattern is saltiness, and modality pattern is heated, overheating, all that. And we have seen the rubric from main chapter, supplement reference table of mind, sensation complaint, and modality. The result was the only remedy that is coming through and through all the three pattern rubric is natrum carbonicum. I started the patient on natrum carbonicum LM1. I just give you a very brief account on how I dispense and follow. The scope of this discussion is about the Boger synoptic key, the pattern of the symptoms, how to identify, where to see, how to rubricate, and how to come to the conclusion. Here I will not elaborate on LM potency, the dosage and all that. We'll have a very short discussion on that. I usually dispense LM potency in 100 ml amber bottle with water and rectified spirit, and add one or two or three pellets of LM1. I generally start with LM1 only and see how patient get adjusted to it, the reaction pattern, and gradually go up to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, depending on the reaction pattern, how the patient tolerate, and how there is amelioration or aggravation, changes in mind, changes in physical symptoms, changes in dream pattern, and less importance to changes in investigation. That comes much later. So what I primarily watch is changes in energy, changes in physical symptoms, the sensations modalities, changes in emotional pattern, and the changes in dream pattern. So these are the things I primarily watch, and later I watch the investigation. So it's all about these things. So I start the patient on natrium or LM1 and not a dry dose. I never give LM potencies in dry dose, and I never use jump potencies by and large. Rare occasions I use jump potencies, but very often and almost always I use LM1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It gives a very, very, very smooth sailing for the patient. There are many doctors who start with very, very high potencies and reported wonderful results, but I have not tried it. So I cannot say a single word whether it is right or safe. I have not tried. So I'm speaking from directly what I have applied, what I know. Okay. So I use LM1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Gradually I go up and travel along with the patient, see how smooth things are, and make very fantastic changes. And I ask the patient to suck the bottle 6 times usually and take 1 lid medicine. Usually 1 lid will be about 5 to 7.5 ml, and mix that 1 lid with about 100 or 150 or 200 ml plain drinking water, stir thoroughly, take 2 spoonfuls from it, and discard the remaining cup of water once or twice a day, depending on the severity of the complaint, acute or chronic, whatever. Okay, so that is the general way how I dispense and ask the patient to take it. 100 ml amber bottle, 100 ml water in that, or 120 ml amber bottle, 100 ml water in that, add few drops of retinoid spirit and indicated remedy LM1, few pellets, and suckers 2 times, 4 times, or 6 times, and take 5 ml or 7.5 ml from this, add in cup of water, stir thoroughly, 2 spoons from that, and discard. This is the most common pattern of LM dispensing I do with my patients, and start with LM1 and gradually go to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now coming back to this case, Herring has given very beautiful guideline which the homeopathic doctor must use. And I generally rely less and less and less upon investigations. What I rely more upon is 2 things. When my remedy is right, when it has produced influence in the patient, when the patient is responding curatively, either there is an unusual discharge will appear along with relief of symptoms. An unusual discharge accompanied by relief of symptoms and a good energy level. The patient should not become weak with that unusual discharge. And there must be very good relief of symptoms which patient is having. So these 3 points must be there. If any one is not there, something is wrong. Unusual discharge. Number 2, reappearance of old symptoms with relief of present complaint with energy level. If patient says weak, something is wrong. There is no relief and there is symptoms reappearing, something is wrong. So all 3 should be present. Please watch very, very carefully. Then externalization of symptoms, a skin rash may reappear. Okay. So along with relief of symptoms, along with good energy level, then the lab investigation or whatever changes will come. Okay. So for this reason, so when these things are followed, all the investigation reports will change. Therefore, I have not presented any of the investigation reports here. I don't retain those things with my patients. Okay. What is more important is these points: externalization, reappearance of old symptoms, an unusual discharge accompanied by relief of present complaints, what patient has, with good energy levels and improvement in emotions, mind, energy, and dream pattern. Okay. So this way, this patient was treated. This patient took up scheme number 3. I will take homeopathy and allopathy. And when patient had a good rally of symptoms and there is good relief, and gradually allopathic drugs were tapered, hand stopped and patient was asked to take pre-diabetic diet also, and still the investigation showed absolutely normal sugar level. All the investigation possible by the diabetologist. Patient is very, very happy. Okay, so this is the work which I did with this patient, and this is the common pattern I do with my patient. The book I refer may be different. When this kind of pattern of symptoms is present, we do the homework of writing down the patient appropriately, then see whether there is any commonality of symptom pattern, the sensation complaint, the mind modality, and concomitant, and see the appropriate rubrics in whatever repertory we are conversant with, and work out the totality and prescribe the remedy that comes. And it is not always that a three rubric pattern what I have presented will give one remedy. Sometimes it will give more remedies also. In that case, I don't ask leading questions. If patient has the result is sulfur, I don't ask them whether you get burning soles and whether you uncover in the night. Rather, I come to the patient and see what is very salient in the patient, and from that I see in the repertory. When we go from a remedy to patient, we are clogged, we are prejudiced, and there are chances of failure is more. Instead, we ask the patient to describe more and see what is very clear in the patient, and from that we come to the repertory or Mater Medica and see what is more delineating and prescribe that remedy. The result percentage is more. So this is another lesson which I've learned over the years. Instead of asking leading questions from our, see when Natramur comes, we ask the patient whether you have chronic grief. Instead of doing that, I see what is present more clearly in the patient, and from there come to the rubric, and the remedy works much better. Okay, so it is from patient to rubric and remedy than from remedy to patient. So this way I work out and prescribe, and this is what I observe in the reaction pattern. So in summary, the techniques and principles involved is, number one, please familiarize with the book contents and its construction. When introduced, he has told very beautifully, Bogar Synoptiki is a condensation of Organon, Repertory and Metaremedy. It is so true. It's excellent, very handy book. You carry Organ, Repertory, Metaremedica wherever you go. It's an excellent book. Fatak used at least 6 copies. You know, he used it so much, wear and tear. Another wonderful book all of you can buy and use it, P. Shankaran's Elements of Homeopathy, Volume 1 and 2. Dr. Rajan Shankaran has compiled and edited. It's a very beautiful work. Elements of Homeopathy, P. Shankaran, edited and compiled by Dr. Rajan Shankaran, where P. Shankaran has given very beautiful account on Bogar Synoptiki, how to use it, case examples. And he says he has used for 95% of his cases, Bogar Synoptiki only, and he has produced marvelous results. Okay, so please read Bogar Synoptiki cover to cover and become familiarized with what is there in the book and how it is constructed. Then you know how to use it. Okay, methods of application on principles. And another thing which I always insist for my friends, colleagues, and students and participants, using 4 types of references or dictionaries. Number one, English mother tongue dictionary. Second, mother tongue English dictionary. Third one, medical dictionary. Fourth one, online references. When we develop the habit of using these things, there is less and less a need for teacher or coach. When we develop these habits, we become our own masters. Okay, and I told you earlier, book, the physical book, please become conversant, and BGM, the older versions are very good. If the old prints are not available with Bogar Synoptiki, IBPS is very good. You can use IBPS print copies, which gives bogus synoptic key in the original form. You can use software, and the website I told you is homeoint.org. There you can see bogus synoptic key. You may reach me through this, or you may give your feedbacks and questions and doubt. If we have time, I think we have some 15 more minutes. The organizer will let us discuss questions and answers here, or you can post your questions and they will redirect your questions and doubts to me related to Bogor synoptic key pattern only, so that you become more conversant with this, not the general questions, because there are many teachers and it is out of scope of this. So we'll start a discussion session. I think the host will take us from here. To the host, sir. Is there any question? Please unmute yourself, sir, and show us.
Thank you, sir. With
questions of participants and discuss.
Sir, there are a few questions from the participants.
Yes, please.
The session was very good, but it was marred by audio problem. There was certain type of breakages in your voice. So one question is, the participant has requested to please repeat the LM potency, how you prescribe and how you dispense that medicine to the patient. Can you please describe the dispensing procedure?
Sure. Say I'm just showing a model. Supposing there is a 120 ml amber bottle is available in the market. I fill that with 100 ml of bottled water which is available in market. I tried with the normal water, it gets spoiled. I tried with the tap water, it gets spoiled. I tried using can waters, it gets spoiled. I get Orva water, it is of no use. So I'm using, say for example, Kinley, Aquafina, or whatever is available in your region. And I fill that amber bottle, which is very clean inside out, and fill with 100 ml water. And then add rectified spirit, 95% alcohol. Add 8 or 10 drops of alcohol with this 100 ml water, so that the water in the bottle and with medicine stays clean for a longer period. That is the purpose of using this type of water and adding alcohol to it. Otherwise, it gets spoiled early. Okay. This is, and to this water alcohol mixture, I add indicated medicine LM potency LM1. Add pill to this. Then I educate the patient to succuss it. Physically, I show this to the patient to succuss it. How to succuss? 2 times, 4 times, or 6 times, not more than that. Okay. And they succuss it. I make the patient do the demonstration in front of me. Mm-hmm. And I am convinced they have understood and they are doing it properly. And then give the original medicine bottle to them. Otherwise, I use a demo bottle, which is empty. And then I ask the patient to unscrew the top lid and pour medicine solution to the lid. The lid will have approximate capacity of 5 to 7.5 ml. And I keep the stock medicine away. And now on my hand, say for example, this is the lid containing liquid medicine. And this is the cup of water which will be kept by the patient. And patient will add lid medicine to water, stir it thoroughly, and take 2 spoons from this.
Okay.
And discard the cup water.
Okay.
And keep the medicine stock thoroughly closed.
Okay.
So stock medicine, water cup, this way. And the dose adjustment, succussion adjustment, how much to take, all these will be adjusted depending on the severity of the complaint and how patient reacts. We have a telephone access to patient and WhatsApp or whatever. They can communicate and get the dose adjustment done.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So there is another question from the participant. What will you do when the case comes to a standstill, doesn't progress or improve?
The most commonest thing I do is when LM potency is not producing result, but I am very sure the remedy is correct, I switch to centesimal potency.
Okay.
And vice versa.
Okay.
Option two. I think there is a block. Okay. I use NOSOD repertory, repertory of NOSODs, SARCODs, and imponderables by Berkeley Square. Do systematic repertorization in that repertory. See which remedy is coming and use that remedy.
So there is another question from the participant. The question is, how do you migrate from LM1 to LM2? Is there any criteria you follow for the migration to the next potency?
Most direct and easy way to count the number of succussion patient does with each bottle.
Okay.
When they complete 100 succussion with one potency, then use the second potency or third potency. That is more direct and easy, sir.
Okay. Okay. Sir, the another question is, do you stop the prescription or do you stop the dispensing of the medicine to the patient when the old symptoms reappear?
Fantastic. We can continue to use LM potency even when the old symptom reappear.
Okay.
That also should disappear. That is the highest ideal criteria.
Okay. So the other question is, in your session, you mentioned that you use mental concomitants for your prescription.
Yes.
So, do you use Herring's analytical repertory of mind for your case references?
I don't have that book, sir. I never read it.
Okay. Okay. So the next question is, do you use Spartak's repertory for solving these type of cases? Similar type of pattern using Spartak's repertory?
I never used.
So the let me sum up the points which you have mentioned for the session, which was a wonderful session. Because of the audio problem, there was some kind of blockage in the entire communication, but we got certain bits of information which might help us, and I'm very sure that we will be trying to make a complete picture out of those bits. So the bits which we got through this communication is that you emphasized on pattern recognition in patients, and you gave a very good example of saltiness, and the saltiness is one of the pattern because that symptom was going through the certain symptoms of the patient, and you gave the example of white granules in the urine and white discharge from the eyes, and white granules in the perspiration. So you took this as one of the pattern, and you combined this pattern with a mental concomitant, and you also added the modality to the case, and you prescribed the medicine. The second point which you highlighted was Berkeley Square's NOSO, and you use this repertory when you come across the blockages in your cases. The other point which you stressed is about the Herring's law of symptoms, especially the reappearance of old symptoms. You said something like unusual discharge, together with the relief of the complaints and increase in energy level. And you also emphasized on P. Shankaran's book on Bogor's synoptic key. You emphasized on Patak's repertory. And you mentioned the four dictionaries, and you also mentioned four schemes to treat the diabetics. And at the end, you mentioned that it is better to be acquainted with the book version of a synoptic key because it consists of the supplementary reference table. So I have given the entire sense of your presentation, sir, and I would like to thank you for giving us a wonderful session and giving us an insight into the pattern recognition in the patients and using this pattern for the selection of a remedy. Thank you very much, sir. Over to Dr. Raisa.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed a great session. I thank Dr. Srinivasan, our resource person of the day, on behalf of Provision 2020 team, Fathomella Homeopathic Medical College. I also take the opportunity to thank Dr. Kurian P.J., Associate Professor, Department of Repertory, for being moderator of this session. Thank you, sir. I also thank our administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Krasta, our principal, Dr. Shivprasad K., our vice principal, Dr. E.S. Prabhugiran, and all the Provision 2020 team for their tireless efforts. Thank you, one and all. And I also thank all the participants of Provision 2020. Today, they had an enthusiastic participation. So tomorrow also, we'll be meeting together. So we'll be listening to Dr. Hima Tilak on the topic Research in the Field of Homeopathy. So thank you, one and all, and wish you good night.